Today, we're going to be speaking with Frank von Hippel, who is a professor at Northern Arizona University and author of the book, The Chemical Age, How Chemists Fought Famine and Disease, Killed Millions, and Changed Our Relationship with the Earth. And Frank, you know, in reading about the history of chemistry and chemists, it seems that a theme with essentially every technological advancement in human history, agriculture comes to mind, nuclear power comes to mind. We both have much good and the possibility of much bad. Am I correctly understanding that that is essentially the broad history of chemistry?
Yes, for sure. And like you're saying, it's also the history with physics and many other fields that lead to technological advances, that we have these wonderful innovations, but they have massive unintended consequences.
I think a lot of times when people think about chemistry, they think about the last 100 years, 150 years, maybe 200 years, and they think of chemicals that include things like pesticides, as an example, or chemistry used in medical technologies. But the history of chemistry really goes back much further than that.
It does. It really goes back to alchemy in a way, where people were using trial and error to find new ways of doing things, often impossible things like trying to turn lead into gold. But those experiments led to a lot of advancements. And I would say that modern chemistry really arose in the early 1800s with the advent of organic chemistry, as chemists learned how to synthesize different kinds of chemicals that are only otherwise found in nature. And that's what gave rise to our modern pesticides, our modern chemical weapons, and so on.
It seems that, correct me if I'm wrong, but there's a bit of an analogous history with what we now know of as two very different fields, astronomy and astrology. At one point, there was an overlap between those, and then they eventually sort of separated. And much the same way, alchemy, which now is the subject of many sort of pseudoscience books and sometimes overlaps with everything from psychics and other things, at one point, it was right there at the start of modern chemistry as well.
That's exactly right. And so with the advent of modern science, where we disprove things and we subject ideas to experimentation, of course, alchemy went away. And we have the modern field of chemistry rise out of that.
When we start to think back in the history of chemistry and thinking about the major breakthroughs within the field, what are sort of like the top level most important milestones?
Well, I would say the first one would be the synthesis of urea by Frederick Wöhler in 1828. And that's really the point of origin of organic chemistry. But there are many others after that. And in terms of the history of pesticides, we had the first commercial pesticide, which was called Bordeaux mixture. It was a copper sulfate solution in the 1870s. And that then led to the proliferation of initially toxic metal-based pesticides. And then we had major inflection points in World War I and World War II. World War I, because it was incredible cross-fertilization of talent of chemists who were working both on pesticides and chemical weapons. So we had pesticides become chemical weapons, and we had chemical weapons become pesticides. And by the end of World War I, a quarter of the artillery shells flying over the trenches had chemical weapons in them, which is extraordinary to think about now. Just that was really a chemical war. It was the chemists who really decided the outcome of that war. And then things got even more advanced and horrific in a way with World War II, where we got the advent of the organophosphate nerve gases like sarin and tavin, which were developed by Nazi scientists, and those developed into the modern organophosphate insecticides after the war.
So early on in the history of pesticides, I mean, my reading of it seems to suggest that this was really seen as just a boon and a great thing, the all positives in the pros column and really nothing in the cons. Because it allowed more food to get to the point at which it could provide sustenance to people, and it provided an expansion of available calories and really solved a lot of problems that were prevalent at the time. Was it that were there people sounding alarms early on, and sort of like, what is the history of when the other side of pesticides started to become more known?
Yeah, it's a terrific question, because initially chemists who were developing these chemicals were fighting scourges of humanity that have faced us since we started agriculture. They were fighting famine, and they were fighting infectious diseases. So famine, because crops are destroyed by pests like rats and cockroaches and grasshoppers and so on, but also crops are destroyed by plant pathogens. And that's what led to the potato blight disaster that caused the greatest famine ever recorded in Ireland in the 1840s. So chemists were trying to fight famine, and they're also trying to fight infectious diseases that were vectored by animals, like malaria and yellow fever, typhus, bubonic plague, and so on. And so the motivations were really good, and these chemicals were quite effective. They were averting famine and averting diseases. But the first alarms really started, I would say, right after World War I. There were a lot of people getting poisoned by toxic metals in their food, especially lead and arsenic, which were used in insecticides and often present on produce. And if people didn't wash the produce, they could get poisoned from it. But even then, it was kind of a grumbling. And then after World War II, there was further grumbling as people saw widespread loss of wildlife. It really wasn't until 1962, when Rachel Carson published Silent Spring, that we saw massive public outrage about the pollution and the destruction of the environment caused by these chemicals, as well as human health effects.
When it comes to, there's now sort of a newer movement of EarthFriendly, and again, it's this idea of so-called pesticides, but they're sort of like non-chemical, EarthFriendly, you know, things. I'm not actually aware of what the substances are, but you'll sometimes hear, hey, you know, you can use you spray lavender on your garden. This is not a real example, but you put lavender on your garden and then put onion peels, and then the animals just don't come near. What does the chemistry community think about that type of thing? Can something totally innocuous really be as effective as some of these more pernicious chemical pesticides? Or is that, in order to get the huge benefit, you've got the huge risk as well?
Yeah, so it's a great question. And unfortunately, with the big benefit of using chemical pesticides, we also create our own dependency on them, because these chemicals not only kill the pests, they kill the predators and parasites of those pests. So they kill the spiders that eat those pests. They kill the parasitoid wasps that infect those pests. They kill the birds that eat those pests. And then you end up being in this vicious cycle where you have to use more and more chemicals to get the same yield. So it's not a simple answer. And really, there are many organic solutions that don't require chemical pesticides that are quite effective. But part of it has to do with the way crops are rotated, growing a diversity of crops rather than a monoculture. If you have 10,000 acres of the same crop, of course you're going to get an outbreak of pests, because it's this giant salad bowl for them. So we need to be thinking holistically about how we grow our food, and at the same time reserve chemicals for when we really need them. In my opinion, that would be for fighting infectious diseases, where we have outbreaks of pests that we need to handle.
Yeah, I found absolutely fascinating Omnivore's Dilemma by Michael Pollan, where he talks about going to Joel Salatin's farm in, I believe it's Virginia, and explains how there's this kind of vicious cycle of, you know, you start to need, for example, antibiotics for cows when the cows are being fed grain instead of grass, because that's not natural for the digestive system of the cow. And it at least makes the case that at some level you can have this regenerative agriculture that doesn't depend on the types of pesticides that you write about in the book. Can that really work at scale?
Yeah, so I think it's a great question that we need to explore as a society, because it hasn't really been tried. We went from operating as small farms throughout the world to having industrialized agriculture after World War II. Population has grown tremendously. And now we need to see, can we do it sustainably? We have to find a way to do it sustainably, because it's certainly not sustainable the way that we rely on chemicals now and the damage it does to our health and the environment. So there's going to be some kind of a compromise where we're using the minimum of these pesticides that one needs to use, while maximizing all of these other benefits of using diverse agriculture and going to a smaller scale, more local markets. Why are we shipping foods all around the world that can be grown nearby? So we need to completely rethink our agriculture.
To go back a little bit to the sort of public health side of the field of chemistry, what do you make generally? I mean, I have more specific questions, but what do you make generally about the types of concerns expressed over the last few months about the coming coronavirus vaccines, some based on the speed with which the vaccines were developed, some based more on conspiracy theories about Bill Gates and microchips, but concerns that at least some seem in good faith about the makeup of the vaccines and the storage and the long term effect on the body. What's your general sense of the discussion around vaccination right now?
Right. So I'm a big advocate of vaccines, and including the new vaccines coming out for COVID. I think they're incredibly important. And although the vaccine for COVID-19 was developed incredibly quickly over the last 10 months or so, the technology it's based on has been in development for 20 years. And so it's a new technology to be employed for a human vaccine, but it's been in development for a long time, and the biology is well understood. So to me, the vaccine looks very safe. It looks efficacious. It's more efficacious than many of us were expecting. And certainly I'll be asking my parents to get it as soon as it's available for older people and for the rest of us when it's available. So the slander against Bill Gates and people like him is just horrible. Here you have someone who's working very hard for the public benefit, using his own resources to do so, and then he's getting attacked for it. I just find it absolutely horrifying that that's going on.
One of the arguments that's sometimes being made, and to call it an argument maybe is a bit of a stretch, but one of the claims that's being made is that we don't know if by testing these vaccines for a few months on people in phase three trials, we don't know if a year, two, three, 4 years down the line, there will be some unforeseen follow-on effects. Now, of course, it's a sort of indefeasible argument in the sense that if a vaccine's been around 50 years, you don't really know that after 51, it doesn't cause some new problem. So you could always make this argument. But in terms of what we know about vaccines, the only thing I've been able to find about long-term vaccine effects that go beyond a few days is a vaccine, the exact one I forget, that doubled the risk of Guillain-Barré syndrome, I think from 1 in 2 million to 1 in 1 million over the life of the individual. What can we say about, generally speaking, at the chemical level, the idea that years down the line, a vaccine could cause something?
Sure. And actually, the example you gave is a good one, because typically where vaccines have an adverse effect, it's at the scale of 1 in 1 million or 2 in 1 million people that have some serious consequence of that. And if you compare that to the serious consequence of getting measles or getting mumps or rubella or tetanus or any of these other things that we get vaccinated against, there's no comparison. So yes, there may be 1 in 1 million, 2 in 1 million people who, due to their genetic makeup and their environment, have some serious consequence of a new vaccine. But look at the mortality rate of people from COVID-19. I mean, we have about 1% or almost 1% of people infected are dying. And that scale, there's no comparison to 1 in 1 million versus 1 in 100. So in terms of vaccine history, I think that's what the lesson is that nearly always they prove to be safe. There are cases where they're not safe. You usually discover that quite quickly. And this happened with the dengue fever vaccine, for example. And so when those problems occur, they're pulled off the market, the problem is solved. And we're very lucky to live in a time where the science is so advanced that something like this can be developed this quickly, rather than us suffering through 30 years of COVID-19 before we have a solution.
Very, very well said. We've been speaking with Frank von Hippel, who teaches at Northern Arizona University. The book is The Chemical Age: How Chemists Fought Famine and Disease, Killed Millions, and Changed Our Relationship with the Earth. Frank, I so appreciate your time today.
Thank you so much, David.